Ok, là tiếng ngõ là phải làm à, tiếng nữa là được không đây nhỉ? Sợ là phải cài Google này, because whenever I present the slides, then I will not be able to see all of you. Mainkan I minimize the presentation tu, because I will not be able to look at the screen. Are you able to see my screen now? Chọn hiện ấy, có phải đó?
Yes,
Dạ phải.
madam, nampak.
Okay.
Crystal
Alhamdulillah. All right. So, you know, ada, let me see how many points. Eh? Kita John Hick, we have just started kan with John Hick, right? So, there are seven points that I'm going to explain about John Hick. Yeah, so I think in the last meeting, I managed to discuss one important point about transformation. Yeah? Transformation is actually present the whole lots of John Hick's idea about religious pluralism, because he called the Christians to do transformation tau. What type of transformation? Yeah, transformation in terms of perceiving the others, because this is a problem of Christianity from Hick's perspective. And you have also to recall what we have discussed during the lecture on Wilfred Cantwell's Macan, that he has also problems in trying to make sense of the Christian perspective of the others. And because why? Because of the extra ecclesia nihil salus and the sola, so the five sola, the way they perceive the others too. Other religions are condemned. People who are not Christians are heathen. Sound familiar tak? Mungkin dalam Islam pun saya, imagine dalam Islam pun macam tu kan. We believe that the non-Muslim world enter will not be will not have the chance to enter Jannah. Yeah. Tapi nantilah towards the end, because I will explain to you how do you understand this in the way Allah meant it, not in the way we interpret it, in the way Allah meant it. Because in Christianity, the issue is they believe that all Christians will definitely go to heaven. No, if you're Christian, you will definitely go to heaven. So they have a problem of what you call that? They have axiological problem, or moral problem. So, for example, what happened if you are a bad Christian? Will you go to heaven as well? That's why in Christianity, there are two important issues. One, two, about problem of evil. And say, for example, you do bad. How about you? And what about, say, for example, tragedies, misfortune that affected someone? Who is responsible for this evil thing that take place in this world? Now that we have COVID, kan, who is responsible? Okay, satu lah. This is about problem of evil. Secondly, about whether you are free or whether you are designated, whether you are free or whether you are determined in doing something. The problems of free will and predestination of qada and qadar. And then you will see that these two problems were the central problem that affect or that trigger for this philosophy of religious pluralism. Because, like I said just now, if you're Christian, then you're going to heaven. But if you're not Christian, you are deprived from the heaven. But then, who is responsible for making you not a Christian? Because the Christians have always believed that you are Christian by the grace of God. The idea of the grace of God ni is like someone who is from the very beginning fated to be Christian. So get God fated that He has grace upon you, He makes you Christian. Tapi it is not the wrong of man, the problem with man that man is deprived from that grace. God determined His grace. Betul tak? So God determine His grace in the sense that, okay, I want you to be Christian, so you are saved. But this fellow B, you are not a Christian, you are not supposed to be a Christian, so you don't have my grace, then you go to hell. So this is actually the problem with the Christian doctrine of salvation that make Hague, Wilford Cantwell Smith and many other pluralists in dilemma. I let you with thought provoking issue, because in Islam, how do we deal with this situation? So what he wanted the Christians, his fellow Christians, remember when he talked about religious pluralism, he was talking to the Christians. He was persuading the Christians, hey, look, let's change the way we look at other religions and we have to do transformation. This is what he wants. So, if we have discussed this, but I'm going to repeat it again, because I cannot just jump to the next point. So he said that we have to make a transformation, make a revolution in the way we understand other religions. Just like Copernicus made revolution to Ptolemaic theory of the earth. Okay, so first of all, I will explain to you in a very brief manner, who was Copernicus and who was Ptolemy? Why we brought this discussion in Hickian concept of pluralism? Okay, so Copernicus lah, his name, as a scientist in the 16th century, if I'm not mistaken, 16th century, and he challenged the existing idea about the earth. He said that based on his discovery, he's a scientist, he's an astrologist, so he studied the universe. So he said that in his findings or in his discovery, he believed that the earth is at the center of the universe, and the sun, the moon, the other planets are Ptolemy. He believed that the sun is at the center of the universe. Copernicus said the sun is at the center of the universe. The moon, the planets, including the earth, revolve around the sun. This is Copernicus' theory of the earth. Because they were discussing, they were experimenting and they were examining about the earth. Yeah? So why this is so a breakthrough at that point of time, because all this while before the 16th or 17th century, scholars, and especially biblical scholars juga lah, biblical scholars and scientists in general believe that it was the earth at the center of the universe. The sun and other planets revolve around the universe, so which means that the center is the earth. So who came with this idea, findings, which particular astrologist or scientist? Ptolemy. His name is Ptolemy, Ptolemy, Ptolemy. Maybe this is I don't remember the date for this, because you can check. And then maybe 3rd-4th century, or maybe earlier than that. What we know, this is Greek scholars, Ptolemy. So you know what? This has created a great havoc, lah, because you are talking about a great changes or transformation, tau, in understanding where the earth is. Because all this while, scientists have been always believing that geocentric lah, that the world is at the center of the universe. Geocentric geocentric in comparison to the idea of the sun at the heliocentric, if I'm not mistaken, yes. Heliocentric is the sun at the center of the universe. So Copernicus had a very hard time to convince everybody, but alhamdulillah, at least the perspective is corrected. Today we believe that the sun is at the center of universe. One findings that helped man to discover a lot of things about the planet. So basically the findings help man to rationalize better of the position of the earth and generate more findings, scientific findings. That's why alhamdulillah, because you know, when we are able to correct the important concept that affect the way men look at the world. Now, what's more, when it comes to religion, it will be a lot of, you know, it's very fortunate that we are able to correct our understanding and perceptions when we are able to find the right concept. Betul tak? Sama dalam konteks, in the context of religion. Because religion is very essential to human life, especially John Hick came from the ministry, kan? I told you this, that he came from the ministry. It's just like you people tau, pada sekolah agama, you're all from religious school, you're all like kind of ulama, kan? And John Hick is also kind of ulama. He's a ulama lah among the Christian. He's a minister, kan? He can conduct sermon, he can conduct rituals at the churches, yeah? So, he said, we have to do Copernicus Revolution to theology. So, he called this Copernicus Theology of Religion. He called this transformation is Copernicus Revolution in theology. Copernicus Revolution in theology. So he said that, look, Christianity, you can gauge from the name, Christianity. Everything is centered around Jesus Christ. Christianity. Christ, yeah? So Christianity, a religion that is based on Christ. So he said, all this while we believe that it is Christianity at the center of the universe. So this is Ptolemaic theology of religion. Christianity at the center of the universe. Now we have to have the courage to look at the fact that it is not Christianity at the center of the universe. It is God who is at the center of the universe. So it is theocentric. From Christocentric to theocentric. God is at the center of the universe. Christianity and other religions revolve around God. So this is a transformation from religion-centeredness, yeah, Christianity-centeredness, to God-centeredness, you know, theocentricness. From Christocentric to theocentric. From Christianity to God-centric. So God at the center instead of Christianity. So this is his breakthrough in the context of Christian theology of other religions. This is very significant to the Christians because, of course, for Hick, this brings a lot of impact to the way he understands Christianity and as well as the doctrines in Christianity. So he believed that it is God at the center because, in his opinion, yeah, he followed Smith's idea that religion is a matter of human interpretation to religion. That's why he wrote a book. I don't know whether I've mentioned this book. His ideas is articulated in his work titled An Interpretation of Religion, Human Responses to the Transcendent. So according to Hick, human, you know, down here, looking at God up there and interpreting God based on his context, yeah, based on his experience, based on his tradition. And remember, Smith talked about cumulative tradition. So he did not say, you know, cumulative tradition as such, but he believed that human is responding to the transcendent, and human or man used whatever context surrounds him to interpret God. And because of that, it is essential for the Christians to change the way they look at other religions, because the way people look at other religions are simply influenced by their context. Not because of, you know, revelation, grace of God, or whatever you can name it. It's solely human responses. It's like human responses to the transcendent. Yeah. So if you notice, if you read books on religious pluralism, you will find that religious pluralism is put under the philosophy of religion. Very, very interesting. Yeah. Because in the Christian sciences, yeah, they have theology. Yeah, theology. In fact, when they discuss other religions, this is put under theology. Yeah, theology of other religions. Yeah, but then theology is very much scriptural based, doctrine based. And you know how Western sciences deal with theology, then? Yeah, so theology is not scientific. So Haig know that if he bring this idea of transformation in the kuliah or in the faculty of theology, the department of theology, in the discourse of theology, he will be rejected. He will not be accepted because the methodology is totally different. So what did he do? He decided that I have to change my area of study. So he enrolled into at Birmingham. He joined the department of philosophy, not the department of theology. Why? Because he said only those who do philosophy will be able to appreciate my idea, my concept, and my revolution. Yeah, my thought-provoking idea. So you see, in Christianity, whenever they have the rational engagement on issues pertaining to religion and interpretation, I would say not Christianity lah, Western context. Eh? Western context is accurately speaking. So they go to philosophy. But if it is rigid and very scriptural based study or revelation based study, they will go to theology. So and this area of science that can deal with reasoning and empirical study are put under philosophy of religion. You learn philosophy of religion, do you? But in the Islamic tradition, we do not differentiate between the two. That's why in Islamic tradition, we don't have falsafatul din. We don't have falsafatul din, the literal translation of philosophy of religion. In the Islamic tradition, we have usuluddin. This is the department where you belong. Usuluddin. So why? Because in Usuluddin, we study religion via revelation, the Quran, the Sunnah, kan? And the views of the ulama, the traditions, yeah? As well as we use reasoning and empirical approach to understand religion. Do you notice that? So our Usuluddin is a combination of theology and philosophy. Because in Islam, we cannot do philosophy solely based on our reasoning and our senses, sensual perceptions. Cannot. We have to be guided by the revelation and by the revelation. So this is, say that we integrate between revelation and reason. This is what IIUM is all about. And this is what the department is intended to do, and that's why we have these two names, Usuluddin and comparative religion. We cannot differentiate comparative religion being a modern sciences that discuss about religion from Usuluddin, because you have to learn Usuluddin and then only you are able to study comparative religion. Yeah, and you can do whatever philosophy, but you have to be guided with Usuluddin. But this is not the context from where he came from, Smith came from. You know how it was in the Western context, and a clear demarcation between the faculty of religion, theology and philosophy. These two does not match. Yeah? Because in the department of theology, you are very much limited by the text, yeah? By the doctrines of your religions. And if you want to be more free, and easy in articulating your ideas, can even no matter how controversial it is, you join the Department of Philosophy. Okay, so this is what he did. He joined the Department of Philosophy and he introduced the idea that Christianity is not at the center of the universe. Christianity is only part of the existing religions, yeah? And Christianity is just like any other religions, because Christianity because Christianity is actually a form of responses to the transcendent God. Yeah. So what do you think the acceptance from the Christians quarters? So he was not very much accepted, yeah? He was not very much welcome. To the extent that he was regarded as heterodox. He was bringing new things in Christianity. Bida'ah lah. Gitu kan. Heterodox is like ajaran sesat, eh? Deviant. Deviant. And he was rejected. He was rejected by the churches of England, the Anglican churches, the churches of England, for his radical idea. Yeah? And you can find on the slide I said, faith is a cognitive freedom. This is what he believed about faith. Faith is a matter of cognitive. It's not a matter of grace. This is what is underlined in this, sentence. Yeah? Faith is not a matter of grace. It is a matter of cognitive. Cognitive is something related to your brain, your intellect. So you are able to choose it. So it's a matter of freedom. As long as it is a matter of cognitive, you are free. Because all sane man is able to make choices with his intellect. Unlike if it is a matter of grace, like what the Christians used to believe. Because the Christian believe that it's a matter of grace. If God has grace upon you, then you're lucky you become Christians. But not if not, then you are unlucky. And you can never do anything about it. Too bad. All right. So from this perspective, I try to deliberate the point that from Hicks try to advocate the idea of transformation in the way the Christians believe, in the way Christians perceive other religions. And this transformation is in the context of understanding salvation. Okay, I have also to use this word. Yeah? Transformation in the context of understanding salvation, because all this while the Christians believe that salvation is exclusive to Christianity. Other religions are deprived from salvation. Yeah, that's why some scholars who rejected Hicks said that Hicks' approach to religious pluralism is very soteriological based. He's challenging the theology of salvation. You have to learn Christianity again. Check what salvation means. You know, in Christianity, when you talk about salvation, you have also to bring together some other doctrines that altogether explain salvation. What are those doctrines? The doctrine of crucifixion, yeah? The doctrine of ascension, the doctrine of resurrection, and the doctrine of incarnation. Some people rule out ascension, yeah? So it's like crucifixion, resurrection, and incarnation. But ascension for me is also important because, okay, first of all, the Christian believe that Jesus Christ was crucified, right? But then they also believe that he didn't die. He was ascended to the heaven. He was, lifted to the heaven. That is ascension. And then after 40 days, the Bible narrated that he showed himself to his companions, to his disciples. So this is the theory or the doctrine of resurrection. He was brought to life again. And when he was brought to life again, this time he was not like any other man. He wasn't man. He became God incarnate, and the doctrine of incarnation. So salvation encompasses these four ideas, crucial ideas about Jesus. So you can just imagine now, if Hicks say that let's define, redefine the meaning of salvation, what happened to these four? These four had also to be reinterpreted. So it's just like if you want to accept religious pluralism in Islam, then you have to revise the way we understand Tauhid. Because this transformation is needed. Which means that whatever religion that want to accept, followers of religious want to accept a religious pluralism, it has to make a self-reflection, critically examine the core belief in his religion. Especially the one that pertains to the idea that this doctrine talks about the ultimate in my religion. Yeah, for example, in Christianity, the ultimate in Christianity is to join God in his kingdom, isn't it? After the afterlife, you know, after the doomsday. You know, because in Christianity, they believe that when the doomsday happen, Jesus Christ will come back to the earth and save the Christians. And the doomsday, sort of Qiyamah, the doomsday will demolish everything on this universe, including men. All men who are not Christians will die. And if you watch this story of 2012, I think, about the big boat, you can. The Christians believe that all men who are not Christians will die, and Jesus Christ will come and save only the Christians. And once when everybody has demolished, Jesus Christ will establish his kingdom. Where? In this world. So this is the ultimate. So to Christianity, that they have to believe in Jesus Christ, because Jesus Christ will save them and they will be reunited with God. Because, and why is it essential for them to believe in Christ? Why not so much on God the Father? Why not so much on the God of the Holy Spirit, but Jesus Christ? Because Jesus Christ says in the Bible, no one comes to the Father except through me. So you have to believe in me if you want to be saved, if you want to be united with God the Father. You understand or not? So this is very crucial concept in Christianity. Yeah? So the whole Lord's idea of salvation has to be revamped. And I will explain to you later what he has in his mind to reinterpret the doctrine. Yeah? So like I said just now, if we Muslims want to accept religious pluralism in the context that, okay, Islam is also a matter of interpretation to God, Christianity is a matter of interpretation, Hinduism is a matter of interpretation, what is more important is God who is at the center, then we have to relook the way we understand Tauhid. How do we understand Tauhid? And the Hindus have to really look the way they understand Moksha. The Buddhists have to change the way they understand Nirvana. Because all these followers of religion believe that, you know, Nirvana, Moksha, Tauhid, Allah is the loose, I'm using it in a very loose manner, is a way of salvation. I have also observation with regard to the word salvation. As you know that the word salvation comes from the root word save, isn't it? Actually, the word salvation is very misleading because it reflects to Christianity. It reflects Christian theology. No, you talk about Islam, there's nothing to be saved. There is no such thing as salvation. Because as I said just now, theologically speaking, salvation refer to these four ideas of crucifixion, ascension, resurrection and incarnation. But in Islam, you don't have this concept of, you know, doctrines altogether. We believe in Allah. That is our ultimate. That is not our salvation.
What are we to be safe from? We are not in the, we are not sin. Okay, another important theory in salvation is also sin, original sin. Because in Christianity, you have to be saved by Jesus because you carry, you inherit the sin. You inherit the sin of Adam. But Jesus Christ has sacrificed himself for all mankind. So you have to recognize his sacrifice, then only you are, your sin will be brushed away. But if we are to take this doctrine of salvation in Islam, what are we, what, which sin are we responsible for? Or which sin are we inherited? We do not regard, or Allah does not tell us, or ulama or Prophet Muhammad did not teach that we are the carrier or the inheritor of the great sin. Because the Quran says that we are like, we are born with Tawheed. وَإِذْ أَخَذَ رَبُّكَ مِنْ بَنِي آدَمَ مِنْ ظُهُورِهِمْ ذُرِّيَّتَهُمْ قَالَ أَلَسْتُ وَلْيَشْهَدَهُمْ عَلَىٰ أَنْفُسِهِمْ قَالَ أَلَسْتُ بِرَبِّكُمْ قَالُوا بَلَىٰ شَهِدْنَا. We believe, we testify that that he is our God and we are his servant. So we are all born with Tawheed. Tawheed is our first religion. This is how Islam look at it. And then the Prophet says, I mean, this is even clearer. The Prophet says, "Kullu mauludin yuladu 'ala al-fitrah. Fa abawai yuhawwidanahu aw yumajjisanahu aw yunassiranahu." So, kullu mauludin, bukannya kullu muslimin, ya. Kullu mauludin yuladu 'ala al-fitrah. We do not believe in the idea that we are born sinner. Ni ada in the Facebook sometimes. I have mentioned this earlier. In Facebook sometimes see people say, oh, aku seorang pendosa. What is that? There's no such thing as aku seorang pendosa. Nah, pendosa means sinner. So there are Muslims these days saying that I'm a sinner. La haula wala quwwata illa billahil azim. Allah never create earth upon our birth as a sinner. We are as pure as clean. Pure as plain cloth. But then we tarnish this because of our context lah. Fa abawa yuhawidanahu aw yumajjisanahu aw yunassiranahu. So we follow the religion of our parents. But we are given the capacity to learn, to know and to choose. This is what differentiate man from other beings. So what I'm trying to say here is that is the doctrine of salvation compatible to Islam? Think about it lah. If we accept religious pluralism, it means that we have to subscribe to this idea of, you know, transforming the way we understand our religion. So let's say we believe that Islam is the way of salvation. So to be saved from what? Give me, explain to us the doctrines that support for the idea of salvation in Islam. Okay, let's take a look at Buddhism. Does Buddhism talk about salvation? No. Siddhartha Gautama Buddha never teach about salvation. He taught about what? About liberation. Save, to be saved from what? Say for example, you know, you a Christian go to a Buddhist and talk about salvation. The Buddhist will not be able to understand it. Because they don't know who was Jesus. What is the relevance of Jesus to their context? They know Siddhartha Gautama Buddha. And Siddhartha Gautama Buddha teach the Buddhists that the only way for you to relieve from the sufferings of the world, dukkha, is by doing meditation. Meditation as a way to achieve nirvana. Nirvana not even talking about saving someone from sin or whatsoever, inherited sin. Nirvana is simply a state whereby you are contented with your existence in this world because you have detached yourself from the world. Because the world is suffering. Life is what? Dukkha. Life is dukkha. So the only way for you to relieve from this sufferings is to let go of the world altogether. Isn't it? So what context salvation is that? And then, but then the plural say, oh, Buddhism also have to accept this, you know, salvation. What type of salvation? It's incompatible. What more in Hinduism? Hinduism spoke about moksha. What is moksha? Moksha is also a liberation. Liberation from the cycle of life, just like Christianity, karma samsara. There's no such thing. In fact, there is no concept of heaven and hell in Hinduism. Betul tak? Hinduism and Buddhism and Sikhism did not talk about heaven and hell altogether. So what's more if you want to talk about kingdom of God? Alright, so you see, this is incompatibility in the context of theology of Christianity and theology of other religions. And why are we going to bring this concept of religious pluralism to other religions? Because we didn't share the same theology. Yeah, and he called this transformation as revolution, Christological revolution. And he look at what the slide say. Yeah, doctrines of Christianity as myth rather than reality. So what is myth? Actually, at the department we have a course titled Myth and Religion. I used to teach this for quite some time, but now it is put under elective. I actually advise the department to put this subject under elective, even though last time we had it in one of the components on the core. Why? Because I think this concept of myth is a modern concept, and we Muslims do not appreciate this concept. Yeah? So you can, and it's very descriptive in nature, because this concept of this theory of myth talks not only about all religions that are prevalent today, but also the Greek religions. So, you know, this concept of myth regard all religions, all religious narratives, religious stories, religious doctrines as myth. Okay, what is myth? Maybe for the Malay, we believe that myth is something that is untrue, but we take it as true. And something that is having no evidence, but we take it because it seems that people believe in it. You know, like for example, the way we understand mahsuri ke, or you know, hang tua. Like we do not have specific evidence, empirical evidence of hang tua or mahsuri for that matter, but we believe it because you know, some truth in it. You know, people have been studying it, but we do not have empirical evidences, like at least rationally speaking. Also, it's quite hard for us to accept that, you know, Masuri was killed and she has white blood, or Hang Tuah was so superb that he managed to, you know, become the warrior of his time, and you know, so on and so forth. Like many legends about Hang Tuah. But are we going to understand the doctrines in Islam, teachings in Islam, narratives in Islam, the stories that we learn in the Quran, okay, as myths? I mean, the story of Isra' Mi'raj as myth, that they are untrue, but we accept it as they are because religion tells us as such. But this is how modern sciences regard religion. Religion is, well, basically, okay, I missed one point. Okay, Malay believe that when you talk about myth, it is untrue, but we take it as true because people, you know, talk about it, you know. So it's like something that is untrue but accepted as true. Yeah? But myth in the modern sciences mean that something that is true but cannot be proved by modern sciences. So you see, true but cannot be proved as by the modern sciences, and therefore you have to take it as it is. Yeah. So all these religions are true, but there are no evidences that can support them. So you study religion as myth, and then if you study myth, you have to study all these Greek pantheons, all these great gods of the Greeks and the Romans and the Mesopotamians and the Chinese traditions, and the Hindu traditions. And so when I teach this subject, I ask the students to search for the names of the great gods, and then they discover, oh, rupanya Olympus, you know, Adidas, Nike, you know, what are these brand actually? These are names of the Greek gods. Interesting. You learn, you check for yourself, because this subject is rather descriptive. That's why I think tak payahlah students of comparative religion learn about all these interesting gods. You can look for yourself. You try to search Adidas, Nike, and many of the brands that we have today are actually names of the Greek gods. Yeah. And these Greek gods in the discipline of myth are accepted as true, even though there are no evidences. And this is what Hick is proposing for Christian doctrine. They are accepted as true, even though there are no empirical evidences for them. So he asks that some of the Christian myth, you know, have to be reinterpreted, have to be interpreted. We will come to that point later, how he interprets incarnation, for example, how he interprets mass gathering, for example. So what else here? And to justify his philosophy of transformation, he used Kantian concept of noumenon and phenomenon. Nomina and phenomena, or nominant and phenomenon. Okay, who is Kant, first of all? I think this is not the first time you learn about you listen to this name, Immanuel Kant. Maybe in my previous lectures, I have talked about Descartes as the father of enlightenment, because he discovered that human mind, human reasoning can answer many of human inquiries or questions. Yeah. Now, if Descartes is the father of enlightenment, Kant is the prince of enlightenment. So, Descartes find the magnificent power of human reasoning. So did Kant. But Kant is more interesting. Why? Because he has propagated one theory about reasoning and religion. So, he propagated the idea that, you know, religion can be accepted if it is reasonable. If you can reason out religion, then that is acceptable. So he is the pioneer of deism in the Western, religion, study of religions, or study of God, theory of origin of religion. Kant is the pioneer of deism. What is deism? Those who believe the idea of God, so long that the idea of God is supported by human reasoning. And Kant has very distinctive way of reasoning or justifying for the existence of religion. He says that religion exists because of moral reason. The reason why religion exists is because man has to be moral. Yeah. So the only justification for religion to exist is moral. Belief system, not even doctrine. Yeah. But man has to be moral, that's why man needs religion. And as long as you can support your religion using rational argumentation, that is acceptable. Yeah. So this and if it John Nick is using Kantian philosophy to justify incarnation, to justify his ideas about religion, especially in the context of philosophy. Remember, kan? I told you philosophy is where you do not tie up yourself with the scriptures, can know whatsoever, but reasoning. Yeah. So what about noumenon and phenomenon? According to Kant, noumenon and phenomenon is Kantian theory of knowledge. Belongs to theory of knowledge, epistemology of knowledge. According to Kant, man knows things into ways, by two means lah. First, noumenon and phenomenon. So knowledge can be defined, can be divided into noumenon and phenomenon. What is that? Noumenon means our knowledge towards the thing in itself, in its core, in its essence. Will we be able to know things in its essence? Yeah, so for example, you talk about, okay, I like to use this mouse that we use for our computer. What is the essence of this mouse? And then phenomenon, the things that you see, the things that you observe, the things that you can think of when you talk about the mouse. So for example, you talk about the mouse must have this shape, must have this function, you know, must have something like this on the bottom. So it doesn't matter, I mean, what shape is it? Maybe we have very, you know, fancy shape, but as long as it functions as it is, then it is a mouse. But what is the core of this mouse? The noumenon is the philosophy of this mouse. What is the philosophy? The core, the essence of this mouse. So according to Kant, knowing noumenon will help us to know things clearer, better, but it's very tricky because it requires a lot of intellection to know things in nominally in itself. But most of the time our knowledge about things are only driven by our by its phenomenon, what we can see from the outside, what we can observe, what we can think of. Yeah, so now this concept of religion, of God, of the ultimate, according to Hick, also refers to this concept of noumenon and phenomenon. So, of course, at first Hick used the word God, you know, God-centric, theocentric, as compared to Christocentric. Yeah, but you know, later on he developed the philosophy of the real or the ultimate or the transcendent. Remember the book, An Interpretation of the Transcendent. He didn't use an interpretation of the God. Is the word an interpretation of the transcendent. And in the context of transformation, he said that, you know, just now we talk about, you know, geocentric to heliocentric, and from Christocentric to theocentric. Yeah, now you're talking about from the real to the real unseen. So using Kantian concept of noumenon and phenomenon. Yeah? So from phenomenon to noumenon, from real to the real unseen. Yeah? So real here refers to the phenomenon. Real with small r, yeah, refer to the phenomenon. While the real unseen, which is the real with capital R, refer to the noumenon. So you can see the line of thought there, because the real unseen or the real with capital R in Hick's language is God. It's the theo. Is God. So he was not inclined to use the word God. Of course he used it at first, you know, because this is his narrative in developing his discourse on this concept of salvation, of transformation. But finally he introduced that we have to use the word the real with capital R, or the real unseen. From transformation from the real to the real unseen. Who are the real? The real with small r, the real with small r, you know, like for example, Nirvana, Moksha, you know, Trinity, Allah, Yahweh, Mukti, and whatever you can name it, that are considered as the ultimate in the different religions. So this is his call, okay? This is what at the core of religious pluralism is all about. So from the perspective of Hick, Allah is the real with small r, and there is something supreme than Allah that is regarded as real unseen, and he is not known. It is noumenon. It is using Kantian vocabularies, Kantian concepts. Yeah? He is noumenon because we can only know him by his phenomenon. Allah is his phenomenon, but not his in essence. We are unable to know him in essence, which means that this God at the center is actually the God of everyone and everybody that is known in different names. I think my problem is not that taking the God as a God of everybody and taking God as a God of everything, because this is how Allah is. He's not only the God to the Muslims, but subscribing to religious pluralism, it means that you have to acknowledge that the rest interpretations of God as valid. So they are merely human interpretation of the noumenon God. And the concept of God that are prevalent in these religions are phenomenon God. So do you accept that Allah is a phenomenon God? That we do not know the noumenon God? Think about it. So that what makes religious pluralism problematic to the Muslims? Yeah, I'm not trying to influence you here. I mean, you're free to rationalize yourself and think properly about this. But if we are to accept religious pluralism, we have to accept it in package. That's why from the very beginning, I differentiate and I say that, yes, there are scholars who accept religious pluralism at the literal meaning, religious plurality. But as a matter of objectivity and scholarship, you know, religious pluralism is not simply religious plurality. You can check my other writings, my writings on this issue. Religious pluralism is not religious plurality. Religious pluralism as a discourse, as a philosophy, is more than religious plurality. So if you want to accept religious pluralism, you have to accept the package and you have to accept the development in the interpretation of religious pluralism. I mean, how this concept evolved from time to time. Yeah, otherwise then you are actually, how do I say it? I mean, it's a shorthand concept of religious pluralism. If you just take it as religious plurality, it's a bit disappointed that many of the philosophers take religious pluralism as religious plurality. And I mentioned this earlier, even Diana L. Eck, when she propagates religious pluralism in America, she simply quieten or disqualify Hicks' conception of religious pluralism. How could she? Because the pioneer of this philosophy was John Hicks. So if you want to understand this philosophy objectively, you have to really go to Hickian's concept. This is the roots of it. Yeah, I remember talking to one great Muslim scholar on religious pluralism, and I actually contested him. He said, how can we accept this, Prof? This is very wrong in comparison to the concept of Tawhid. It's contradicting to Tawhid. And this professor said, Yaslina, you can redefine it. You do not have to accept it as Hicks understood it. But then he said, well, but then every time you talk to people, you have to say, oh, this is my version of religious pluralism, not Hickian's version of religious pluralism. Is that what you mean? So what is the objectivity and fair and justice in knowledge? You have to be honest to knowledge, then. I think what I'm trying to stress here is to be honest with knowledge. Who came with this concept? Why he was trying to advocate via this concept? What brought him to this concept? And what he has to let go to propagate this concept? This is doing justice to John Hickton. So you cannot just simply hijack the term and use it at your own liberty without recognizing where this come from and what this has served John Hicks in his scholarship. I mean, I'm not trying to say that, oh, Hicks is wrong in this and that, but objectively speaking, I am attributing this concept to him because he's a pioneer. Yeah, and this is how my professor also nurtured us when he taught us, you know, before you take any of the concept that come from a foreign environment, you have to understand that this concept did not emerge in vacuum. It has its own historical baggages, it has its own context, own history, and you have to understand its history in order for you to understand the philosophy. Because I can see some of my students, even last semester, the semester before last semester, oh, still accept religious pluralism. I'm very sick of this, because how can you accept religious pluralism knowing that this concept has a lot of, it's a lot of issues. Yeah, and you have to be very fair. Okay, so that is about transformation. The second point is about why Hicks, the way Hicks understand why men are in different religions. Yeah, so he said that men follow the different religions because it is by chance, by the fortuity of birth, depends where you are born. If you are born in Malaysia, I think Hicks is misleading in this. Because in Malaysia, we have different race, different culture, and different ethnics, different religions, kan? But it seems that Hicks believe that if you are born in Saudi, then you are a Muslim. If you are born in Rome, you are Christian. If you are born in Malaysia, are you Muslim? So maybe not Muslim. I mean, that is very difficult to answer because in Malaysia, we have like 60-40. Distribution Muslims and non-Muslim, right? Muslims for 60% and 40% non-Muslim. So, what is the likelihood for you to be born as Muslim and non-Muslim in Malaysia? Very difficult to gauge. Yeah? But this is what Hicks believe. I mean, it's a matter of where you're born. If you're born in European countries, one of the European countries, you'll be Christian. Hey, now there are many Muslims in European countries. Yeah, if Hick is still alive today, he may need to change his perspective because you're not determined by the place where you're born. Yeah, but this is how he explained man is, you know, man follow a certain religion because of the context that he lives in. Yeah, and just now I narrate you one of the hadith, kullu mauludin yuladu ala al-fitra. There is some truth in it, but make a quick judgment. There is some truth in it, but don't make a quick judgment yet, because you have to relate with what Allah says in the beginning of in the end of this hadith and in the Quran. Yeah, I want to recite this again. Yeah, wa idh akhadha rabbuka min bani adama min zuhurihim dhurriyyatahum qala alastu bi wal yashhadahum ala anfusihim qala alastu bi rabbikum qalu bala shahidna. You know, the religion of man from the very beginning is the religion of tauhid. All men without exception from the very beginning was tauhidic. He believes in the single God, in the God that creates him. Right? Because when God asks him, as man regain his, sanity or consciousness, he started to realize himself, and God asked him, "Alastu bi rabbikum? Am I not your Rabb?" And then man said, "Qalu bala shahidna, I testify." So the Muslim scholars believe that every man from the very, very beginning followed the religion of Tawheed. So from in Islamic perspective, God is not biased. Every man from the very beginning is following the religion of Tawheed. And the hadith explain why man differs. Man differs because of his context, and that's the part of the truth in that hadith. So we follow the religion of our parents. Yeah, but then remember, as Muslims, we follow the religion of our parents
but we are responsible to make sense of the religions because we are given the mind to think. This is what give man's credibility, yeah, better rank in comparison to other beings. Remember we discussed this earlier, kan? That man is having the capacity and is responsible because of this capacity. Now, what if man does not have that capacity? He is not going to be responsible. So you see, you know, when I wrote my thesis on religious pluralism, I started to think a lot also about this. What happened, why men are in different religions, and what happened if they are non-Muslim just because of their context? Maybe I've told you my experience when I went to Germany and I met my German friends who were good, but they were in searching of religion. They did not believe in Christianity, yeah? But they follow Christianity as a tradition. It's just a matter of culture. But they are actually looking forward for the right revelation to reach them. And one of the things that I regret so much was that, you know, my presence there and my friends there, were we able to enlighten them about Islam? Because I think by the virtue of looking at us, they will get the message that Allah wants to Muslims to communicate to all over the world. What being Muslim is all about. And that's why we call people who come to Islam revert, not convert. Eh? Because revert means a person restore his belief in Tawhid. Now, if we look at this, you know, in a very, you know, internalized aspect, then we know that we are not doing our role. At least when I went to Germany, I found that there are many Christians who are in search for the truth. They no longer go to the church. The way they explained to me, because I remember we had a touring session. We went to a place named Weimar, where the monastery is there, and Martin Luther was from Weimar. Yeah, and that was when he protests against the church. And then this friend, the German friend, told me that she never liked the church. She has not yet baptized, but she every year she will go to Tanzania with her missionaries, with the missionaries in German, to teach children to learn, to read, to make them literate. And then she asked me this question: am I going to hell just because I'm not Muslim? No, but she said that she's a very good person. She didn't fornicate, you know, the German society. They love to be together without marriage, and they don't appreciate marriage that much, because I mean the tradition in German, at least when I went to Germany in 2003 or 2004, if I'm not mistaken, the tradition there is that, I mean, if you want to marry, then you marry at the church and you affiliate yourself to the church, right? And then they thought that the church is taking a lot of people's money, and they actually didn't like it. The way she explained to me, you know, the Christians go to the church only for two things. First, to baptize. And secondly, to get married, yeah. And thirdly, when you are died, then the church will do the rituals for you lah, the rites for you. But that is after you are dead. But when you are alive, you need the church only for these two purposes, and that makes it very unattractive for the Christians in Germany to be with the church. One is to baptize. Secondly, is to get married. So many of the Germans, they don't choose to get married because this is also something to do with the government policies. The government policies is that if you are married, then you qualify only one allowance. Because in Germany, if every man has the allowance, especially if you are not working. If you are not working, you have allowance. The allowance that time,
2 weeks. For 2 weeks, you will be getting it 2 weeks, every 2 weeks, not even a month. 2 weeks, you will be given 250 euros. 250 euros from the government. If you're not married and you're jobless, you're student, kan? So you will get 250, which means that monthly you will get 500 euros, enough for you to survive. So, but if you get married, the couple were only eligible for one allowance. So that's why she said to me that what's the point of getting married? Because if you marry, then you get only one allowance. And what's more, you have to get married in the church. And, you know, it's very difficult. It's very impossible to untie yourself from the marriage, because marriage in the Christian's tradition is a sacred tie. It's more than contractual, though. It's a sacred tie. In Islam, marriage is contractual, but in Christianity, it's a sacred tie. So it's very difficult to be apart, to divorce in the Christian tradition. So, you know, I go back to this concept of fortuity of birth. In Islam, yes, we don't believe that our religion is determined by our contracts. Yeah, we believe that we are all believers of Tawheed, but we became in particular religion because of the context. And because of that also, I think we Muslims have to do a lot to help non-Muslims to at least think about Islam. Because once when they know about Islam, think about Islam, they have the responsibility to look for an answer about Islam. That's the best that we can do. I mean, that's the best da'wah that we can do to the non-Muslims by helping them to think about religion. Yeah. But with regard to John Hick, he believed that religion is a matter of context. So it depends in which context you are in. And Hick, to justify this, I will leave you with this. Yeah? To justify this, he quoted from Xenophanes. So this Xenophanes, historian, a great historian. Xenophanes said that actually man create his God. He gave this citation like, Xenophanes said, if you go to the Utopians picture that their gods is black and have turned nose. You know, people who are black, they envision that God is black and have pointed nose. If you go to the Europeans, Russians make them with red hair and blue eyes. You know, if you are this look, then you imagine God as this look. Yeah? Mortal thinks that gods are born and have their own food, voice and shape. If you believe in mortality, you know that you're going to perish, then you start thinking about God also perish like you. Yeah? And you know, the people in the past who live in nomadic way, like you move from one place to another, after the place has lost its fertility, you move to another place. Kan? And you start to think about that God has to be strong, because you need this when you move from one place to another. But after some time, when men become more mature, more intelligent, more clever, he started to settle down. He led a sedentary life, settle down in one place, start to do farming, you know, and planting. And then men depends very much on the fertility of the ground. And when men start to think about fertility, they start to think about, fertility is character of women, and God must be female. So you see, what he was trying to justify is that the religion of man is determined by human interpretation, by human context, you know, another extension of this, an interpretation of religion, human responses to the transcendent. So I will stop at this point, and inshallah, I will see you again next week, and I will share with you, I don't know if I share with you these slides, I will share with you this lecture. And inshallah, next week we will finish on John Hick and we will move to the next discussion, inshallah. So, any question before I let you go? I assume that there is no question. If you have any question regarding your assignments, please email me. Thank you. Assalamualaikum everyone. See you inshallah.
Waalaikumsalam.
Thank you,
madam. Thank you, madam. Okay, have a nice day. Breakfast. Okay.
Thank you.